So the first, yes.
Is it okay if we start one form x plus three over two, or do you want it like not specific?
Well, I don't want decimals in there. You should never have a decimal in a fraction, but you separated it, but still leave it to me as fractions then.
I did, I said three over two.
Three over two? Oh, okay, sorry. Sorry about that. You could, yeah, you could separate that, it's an equation of a line, absolutely. Give it to me as an equation of a line. Sorry, I misunderstood you completely. Anna said she just separated this because this is an equation of a line like we did yesterday. Absolutely.
So she got 1/4 x plus 3/2. And that shows us that this is a line. However, here's the problem. My line extends and comes out here. I do not want that part. So therefore, you have to be very careful. When you find your domain for the first part, make sure you swap them around. They interchange. And I put a decimal, so we'll leave them as a fraction. It works even better as a fraction. As long as it terminates, it doesn't matter. So make sure you give me the new domain for this. Otherwise, it's going to use the whole line. And you don't want the whole line. You also have to make sure that you give me f to the negative 1. And that you put that piece on your graph. Right? We had two increasings, two decreasings. And I'll tell you which one I want you to do. Here's another increasing part, and really we had no choice anyway, because if you take your domain for this, this becomes, there's your domain. It just becomes this part. So even though I said increasing, you had no choice. You only had an increasing function. Okay, now here's where it gets tricky. After you find your inverse, this is actually a parabola that comes across this other way. And I don't want that part. I don't want to see it on your graph. So now that would give me my parabola. I definitely have to put these with this. If you don't get to change your domain and your range, it's wrong. Because you're telling me it's a parabola, and it's not. It's only a part of that. It's a restricted part. Generally, if you restrict the first part, you don't have to restrict the second part, and vice versa. Sometimes you end up restricting both. But in this case, my first part was okay, but when I square it, I got a problem. Good? Yes? Tell me no if it's no. Okay, these guys were decreasing. For some odd reason, kids have trouble on the decreasing part. The decreasing part, graph that part only. Kind of figure out where your point is. You know this from your transformations. You move 4 horizontally to the left. So your 0, 0 went to negative 4, 0. If you interchange that point, do it on your graph. It's going to be 0, negative 4. I need this to be a reflection of this line. So therefore, I can kind of see what it's going to look like. And then when you put it in your calc, you'll see if you've got the whole thing or if you've got part of it. If you get the whole thing, then you definitely got to give me a restriction. If you only got that piece there, you're good to go. So we restricted this part to the decreasing. Once we took the square root, this is where we said it's positive or negative. I only want the negative. So I put my negative in there. Now when you graph that, that will be that little piece. If you hesitate, just put your domain and your range there anyway. Put it there anyway. Because this said the decreasing portion. So you're going to get 2 when you take a square root, or when you do an absolute value, you're going to get 2 paths. If you're doing the increasing, you take the positives. If you're doing a decreasing, you take the negatives. And that's why for some odd reason, kids just don't like those decreasing parts. Yes? Okay, and your last one that you had This is also a decreasing part. Now this raised to the fourth power works just like a parabola. It looks just like a parabola. Sometimes you get a W, sometimes you get a parabola. So put it in your calc and only give me the decreasing part. You're at positive 3 to the right, up 2. So there's your point that you're going to start, positive 3, 2. Interchange that point. Your inverse is going to start at 2, 3. And it's going to have to be a reflection over this line. So it's got to go this way somehow, right? It's going to have to only give me one part to it. So when you do this, this will give you the one part. Just give me your domain anyway. And actually, when you do this, this kind of shows you how they all tie together. When you take your domain and your range and you interchange it down here, this is your exact domain. Because if I did this domain, I'd say greater than or equal to 2, right? And I got a greater than or equal to 2 because that was my range from my original one. So it does kind of show you how it all fits together. You don't need your range when you give a restriction, just your domain. Questions on any of these? Okay, while you're looking at that one, I'm going to hand out today's work. Monday. We're going to spend a couple of days on this. Your test for the next unit has the same setup. One part got a calc. So what I did was I just separated it out. We used to do them separate anyway, Ms. Fernandez and I, and then we kind of combined them into one which is long. So it works out better to separate them. So you're going to be doing this without a calculator. And you're going to be amazed. Your two kids like this because it amazes them how much they can find out about a parabola. You know, you'll be amazed. So we're going to talk your basic quadratic function. I know last year, probably even a little earlier, probably in Algebra 1, you also put your quadratic functions into vertex form. Without the vertex form, you can't graph it. So your vertex form, and you're going to see as soon as you put it in your vertex form, that's your transformations right there. So that's what allows us to graph this. So we're going to start with this format. And we're going to get it to this format. This is called our vertex form. And your vertex form is where your transformations come from. So that makes it nice to graph. As a rule, if A is greater than 1, if it's positive, it opens up. If A is less than 1, if it's negative, it opens down. HK is your vertex. Now, you can see from your transformations, if I did this, my vertex of this?
3, 5, 2, 4.
2, 4, because what's my transformation here? Where do I go? To the right. So inside the parentheses, I go to the right in this case. I go the opposite way. So therefore, your vertex comes out the opposite way from the parentheses. Because this is your transformation. Oh, go to the right, 2, go up 4. There's my vertex. It makes total sense to me.
So it would be the opposite.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Because inside, your transformation is the opposite way. Your axis of symmetry is just a vertical line that goes through the vertex. So because it's a vertical line that goes through my vertex, this is an x equal line. It just has to hit the point of H. I just have to call it that line. So that's why we get x equals H. It's just a vertical line that goes through the vertex. The roots are your zeros of your parabola, your x-intercepts, as we've been doing them, is when x is when y is equal to zero. We will also do your y-intercepts. We always do the both of them when x is equal to zero. So we're going to take that basic quadratic and we're going to put it into vertex form. We're going to apply our transformations and we're going to graph it. And we're going to look at our intercepts because sometimes we're a little close to the, where are we, to the left of the 0, 0, to the right of the 0, 0, how wide is it? You know how you always say to me, how wide do I graph a compression or shrink or a stretch, how wide? You'll be able to see what your intercepts now. You'll be amazed at what you can do. It is amazing, truly. So now, we're going to start with this guy. Here's a parabola. What can you tell me about that parabola? The y-intercept is 7, okay. That was very good. How did you know that? Okay, at the end it says plus 7, so your y-intercept says let x equal 0. So Patrick put the 0 in, 0 squared. He could go like this and say y is 7. So he knows something about this parabola. What else do you know about that parabola? It opens up. How did you know that? A is positive. So we know somewhere that this opens up. Can we tell anything else about it? No, you're good? Well, you're going to be a lot better because we got to be able to tell everything about this. So now, to do this, we have to put this into vertex form. To do that, we have to complete the square. Your vertex form is this. We'll talk about the A in a second. Oops, sorry. Okay. I messed that up, didn't I? Yeah. Okay, we'll talk about the A in a second. That A is your stretch and shrink. So we'll talk about that in a second. Now, two ways. Some teachers teach all in one on one side. Some teachers teach two sides of the equation. It doesn't matter to me which way you do it. I'm going to do it on one side because we have to make an equation. Generally, you do it on two separate sides because you're solving for your zeros. But if you want to do it two separate sides, I'll do that with you too, and then you can just slide it over to the other side. I don't have a problem with that. The difference is this. In this case, always put your x's together anyway. This is where you're going to complete the square. If I'm going to put this on this side, then I have to subtract whatever it is I added, right? Because I'm on one side. If you put this on two sides, you're going to add to one side, add to the other side. That's the only difference. So I'll do this, and then I'll do it on two sides. Group your x's together. Leave the other part, the constant part, by itself. Trust me, you don't want to group that with this guy. Now, rule is, this is my B term. Take half of B. What is half of negative 4? So go like this, minus 2. Here's my square. What is 2 squared? Four. Doesn't matter if it's negative. What is negative 2 squared? 4. Here. So you have just completed the square. And then this is what's left over. So my equation says this. do it on the other side.
I'll just click do it over here. You move, set this equal to zero first. Because this, the reason we set that equal to zero is because you're usually going to solve for your zeros for this, which is why you're able to move the 7 over there. I left it y equal because I wanted the equation. But if you like this, subtract 7. Now here's where you complete the square. If you add to this side, you add to this side. So there's my x minus 2 squared. There's my 4. There's my 4. So I get this. Since you need, this is where you usually solve for your zeros. Take the square root of both sides. That's why you set it equal to 0. If I need an equation, just move this over. I don't care which way you're more comfortable with, as long as you end up with an equation. Okay? Now, I know a whole lot about this now. What's my vertex? What's my axis of symmetry? 2, but doesn't it have to be an equation of a line? X equals 2. So here's my graph. So I say 2, 3 over here, and it opens up. We already knew that it opened up, so we're just going to make this and go up. Okay. Does that approximately look like 0, 7? Yeah, close enough to the 0, 7. You already told me it was 0, 7. Okay. X-intercepts. If we're finding our x-intercepts, we're going to do exactly this. Do we have to redo this whole thing all over again? No. All we're just going to do here is subtract 3 to the other side and end up right here. That's where you put your 0 in. That's why your teachers did that, to find your roots. So we're going to take that equation, and we're just going to put a 0 in for y, take the square root of both sides, can I take the square root of a negative number? So these have no real roots. These roots are imaginary. And my intercept, I'm going to keep it the way Patrick gave it to me. Go back to your original, plug in the x of 0. Easiest way. So our intercepts help us graph this.
If I know this is 2, 3, I know my 7's not way up here, not right over here. I know exactly where it is. If you graph your equation, and then you do your intercepts, and it's not where you thought you were supposed to be, go look at how you completed the square, or look at how you solved for your intercepts. One of those is off. And when you get back your first test, I'll even say on some of them, is this possible on your graph? Look at your graph. So we're completing the square to get to your vertex form. From there, we apply your transformations. We say, my squaring function moves 2 to the right, moves up 3. 2 to the right, up 3. A is positive 1, which is the same thing here. A was positive 1, so I'm opening up. Make sense? Okay. Now, here comes the hard one. Everybody good with this? Okay. Here comes the hard one. Oh. Somehow this is all really off. Tell me about this quadratic. Ah, it's a stretch. What made you know that? The 2. It's a stretch. It's a vertical stretch. Good. So far we know this is a, well, this is a vertical stretch. I don't know how this gets off so much. So we know this is a vertical stretch. What else can you tell me about this? Which way does it open? It opens up. What else?
Good. Y-intercept. Y-intercept again, I can plug in when x is 0. This is the easiest format to use rather than the complete square one, because your x's just come right out. So if I substitute in my 0, I get y is equal to 7. So again, this is my y-intercept. That's all I know, right? The math, let's put this into vertex form. Vertex form says this, and this time we'll see that a out there. Okay. We're going to do it on one side. We're going to keep our x's grouped together and complete that square. So whatever we add to this thing, we have to subtract. But a has to be equal to 1, positive 1. I have a 2 out there. So I have to factor out this 2 first. Now, this is why I say keep that 7 separate. You don't want to factor a 2 out of your 7. Just these guys. Just basically this piece right here. This is where you're going to complete the square. Again, what is half of positive 4? 2. So say to yourself, positive 2, there's your x plus 2. What is 2 squared? 4. Now, this 2 is a factor that we factored out. We have to carry this 2 down with us. Ah, didn't Michael say we have a stretch? There's my stretch, right? Isn't that what my transformations tell me when it's sitting outside there? There's my stretch. Now, I can't subtract 4 because it's trapped inside these parentheses. To get it out of that parentheses, I have to distribute the 2. What is 2 times 4? That's what I'm going to put over here. And I'm going to get a minus 1. There's my, if you could read this, all my scribble on it. Because I completed the square, right? 2 squared is 4, but 4 is trapped inside these parentheses because it's really not x squared, isn't it? Isn't it 2x squared? Isn't it 8x? So it's really not 4, it's really 8. You got to get it out of that parentheses. So now I can leave it that way. What is my vertex? Negative 1. What is my axis of symmetry? X equals negative 2. Good. So now, let's see what we can tell from my graph. I've got a vertex point, negative 2, negative 1. Here's my problem. When I open this up, it's going to open up. Am I on the left side of the 0, the right side of the 0? Where am I? Well, the 0, 7 is helpful to me. I could possibly be on the left side. I've got a stretch, so it's not as wide. It's narrow, right? That 2 gives me a, my transformation says, move 2 left, move 1 down, and vertically stretch this thing by a factor of 2. So let's do your x-intercepts when y is equal to 0. Go to the completed the square one. So I'm going to add 1. I'm going to divide by 2. How do I do a square? Square root. Now remember, when you take the square root, you get a plus or a minus. And then I'm going to subtract 2. I'm not really sure where that puts me, but, oh, P.S. You could leave this, let me write this over here. You can leave this in your radical, as long as you can't reduce it. If it was 1/4, I would have to reduce it. You don't have to rationalize like you did in Algebra 2, before you had to do this. radical 1 over radical 2, so you'd get radical 2 over 2. Remember doing that? You do not have to rationalize. However, you do have to reduce them, and you do have to take out any perfect squares. But that you can leave. Now, put this in your calculator, just in, not your y equal, just in a regular calculator. Do negative 2 plus the square root of 1 half, and negative 2 minus the square root of 1 half. We could estimate that if you didn't have a calculator. We could estimate it. Because radical 2 over 2 is like 1.4. But you could put that part in your calculator. And from there, what I care about is my 1 over here. Is it to the left of the 0 or to the right of the 0? Am I still in the negatives? I'm still in the negatives, right? So now I know I'm going like this. Put 1 over here. You guys are, you know where I'm coming from here, somewhere down there. Okay, I know what my parabola looks like. It's narrower. My 7 showed that to me, and so did my 2x value show that to me. And that's my 2. That's my 2 right here, my stretch. So look at all the stuff we found from that equation. All we knew that was the parabola, it opened up, and we did have the x, the y-intercept. And we knew it was a stretch, so we knew it was going to be narrower than usual. But I found the vertex, the axis of symmetry, found the roots, and we were able to sketch it. All without using a calculator. Pretty good, right? Questions on this at all? Huh? Are you overwhelmed? It's amazing. Aren't you amazed? You must be amazed. I got one more thing to do for you. Actually, the most amazing story. I tell this every year to my kids. Well, every year it gets a little further away that I had this child. I had a girl who was starved for trafficking. She got a full ride because she went on and took out for two. But she hated out for two, and she had to take pre-cal to get her scholarship. So she took me, she had me for regular pre-calc, and every day I heard, I hate this math, I can't do this math, I'm going to fail this class. And every day she stayed with me, period 9, every day. And when we were doing this and she was graphing this, she was amazed at what she could do. She was like, I went home, I showed my mom, she had no idea what she was looking at, but I showed her all the things I could do. She's the one, and I'll wear my sweatshirt, she made me the Dot Calculus sweatshirt. She was so excited. She made me a Dot Calculus sweatshirt, and she got a full ride because she had pre-calc. And she got an 82 on her final. She actually said at a few different times, I actually like this stuff. So see? See? You might be saying that too pretty soon. All right, so the last thing we're going to do is find the equation of a parabola. Now, I know what my format looks like. If you don't, that you do have to memorize. I don't know what that A means, but I'll figure it out. Because sometimes we had a number out there, which we just saw we had a 2, right? First one we had a 1, then we had a 2. I know this is my vertex, my H, and my K. So first thing I'm going to do is just plug this in. Okay? We know our vertex. Still got that A out there. I don't know what to put in my A. So they've got to tell me a little bit more information. They told me that this parabola passes through the origin. This is my x, my y. So now I'm going to substitute in a 0 and a 0. And I'm going to find out what my a is. So 0 is equal to a times negative 1 squared. What is negative 1 squared? 1. I subtract, and a is equal to negative 2. Now I know this. So here's my equation. Negative 2, x minus 1 squared, plus 2. Easy way to check this. Put this in your y equal. Does it have this vertex? Is that the turning point, 1, 2? Does it pass through the point 0, 0? God bless you. Those are nice to check. You guys did great. I know this was a long period. It was
wonderful, that's what I love to hear.